From starting at the bottom of the industry to working your way up to being a respected director of photography to now producing a movie that I think is a fantastic concept, a brilliant idea, I want to interview today somebody who's going to help you understand how to navigate Hollywood, particularly as a person of faith, and how to keep your integrity and be successful at the same time. The first time I ever worked with Stephen Ashley Blake was on a project probably 10 or 20 years ago, for that matter. You were a film DP. I thought you were probably way out of my league, but we brought you on board, and you changed the way I look at everything when it comes to photographing a scene. Your lighting, you know, composition, you're a great influence on me. Let me just say that. And so that's why I'm so excited.
You told me that like 15 years ago.
Well, I was too busy yelling at you.
Security complex, right.
The interesting thing is you have always been on the move. Now you're producing a new project. You're developing a new project. And so, first of all, welcome to the podcast.
Great to be here.
We are thrilled that you are here and very excited about how I want you to share a little bit about what's happened in your career. Tell me, let's start with where you came from. Did you study this in college? Did you grow up in the industry? Where did you get started in this business?
Well, I never went to college. An uncle gave me a home movie camera when I was 8 years old, a Super 8 camera, and that just set my course for life. Immediately, I began recruiting neighbors and casting them to star in these spontaneously created sort of pixelated / live action adventures.
3 minutes, because that was a reel right then, wasn't it?
Exactly. You had, yeah, exactly.
Three-minute reels.
Yeah, in the regular 8 days, you had to then turn it over and expose the other side of it before Super 8 came around. So I was a regular 8 guy first, then came Super 8.
Funny.
And then I was mentored at a place called the Pasadena Art Workshops in Pasadena by a brilliant filmmaker named John Clark Matthews. And I would later become mentored by another great filmmaker called William Moffat.
Yeah.
Bill was an Emmy Award winning and is an Emmy Award winning director and DP. And that sort of ushered my way into Hollywood proper. I began interning for a producer called Arnold Shapiro at KTLA, Golden West Broadcasters, when I was in high school.
Yeah.
So I'd leave high school at lunch and drive down to LA in my 73 Olds Toronado that broke down half the time to get there. And then that actually transitioned into line producing. And I worked with the great DP Jordan Cronenweth. He was huge. I didn't know really who he was.
Wow.
I was a PA on a shoot for Pioneer Stereo, and the producers were so stoked at having landed this guy. And so they said, watch his work. And they shot it at a stage in Hollywood. I tagged along, and it was so breathtaking that I said, this is actually what I want to pursue doing, which paved the way to, I actually directed some stuff for KABC Television for a time, and I became a feature DP, and did a lot of genre films, no budget jobs for $100,000, and then that transitioned to doing music videos and other things, so I was off and running after a time.
Now, that world has changed dramatically in your career, from film world to the digital video world. You know, how important is it to stay on top of what's going on out there?
I think it's vitally important to know what's happening technologically, to stay abreast of it, absolutely. But at the same time, I think that it's got to be remembered that art is really not about the technology. It's really about the artist and about the vision you're putting forth. And I think it's a valuable thing, for example, to continue to study the great masters in cinematography.
That's good. That's
absolutely. Good. Because at the end of the day, even if you get a fancier paintbrush, the question is, what are you going to paint and who are you, the painter?
Yeah.
And I am dismayed by a lot of emphasis on technology, which can be mesmerizing, but at the same time, not as much attention. I'd say 9/10 of attention should be on really immersing yourself in the great works. For example, if you're a cinematographer, of James Wong Howe and of Haskell Wexler, of Jordan Cronenweth, of great DPs over the centuries, and to understand then what creates a great image. And how do you tell a story? If the sound were to be shut off in a theater for some reason, how would the audience be able to track the evolution of the story, for example, through your photography, through costume design, through production design?
That's good. In fact, I've been on projects where I sat down with the costume person, the lighting director, or the DP, different people on the crew, and said, okay, how are you going to tell this story through the costumes that you select or the lighting that you create?
And I think the best filmmaking is a coming together of really different directors. It's interesting that even back with Gone with the Wind, the great David Selznick, and by the way, I really commend the reading of the making of Gone with the Wind through his memos.
Oh,
any perspective or even working filmmaker. And he really, for example, expected really directorial expertise and excellence by his production designer. In fact, he kind of created the figure of the production designer as a more grandiose and a more comprehensive role than had been ever done before, and even than many do today. But I think really great filmmaking is a coming together of directors. I think that an actor who is there to flesh out and put one character on screen, there's an arc to that character, and that actor needs to really own the evolution of that character, and I think the DP needs to do the same with respect to photography, production design, and costuming, and then of course you come together under the aegis of the director, who sort of wrangles these things, and I think allows these independent department heads to sort of come together and congeal and create something that I think ultimately is much greater than the sum of the parts.
That's good. So. That's good. You know, one of the things I've noticed is in this age of video, YouTube, and everybody's got a video camera and their phone, the thing that I'm seeing that's lacking is lighting, really great lighting. And just because you can grab a camera out of your pocket and shoot something doesn't mean you're going to tell that story well. How important is lighting to anybody in the film business or television or film?
Lighting is so crucial that in the European tradition, for example, the DP handles pretty much lighting alone, and the camera operator often interfaces with the director about the composition of the shots. In fact, Vittorio Storaro, the great Italian DP, pressed to have the credit vision, actually, what was the title? Visionary of Light or something. That's what he wanted as his screen credit, for example, on there's a Richard Donner movie he did, Lady Hawk, I think it was. Yeah. And he wanted like something like Visionary of Light, and Donner said, no way, you're going to be the DP on this job. But lighting is essential because obviously here we are at a table and we can depict this and convey what's happening, not only what's happening overtly with respect to the story, but the subtext also. What's happening in you? What's happening in me?
That's good.
And you can paint this portrait in any number of ways. I remember doing a movie, it was a film I did early in my career called Hollywood Shuffle with Robert Townsend.
Okay.
I was one of three DPs on that job.
Really?
One of three DPs. And
talking
one
about
of
a Hollywood Shuffle.
Exactly. Well, they shot over the course of like 2 years, and he put it on his credit cards, and so they only had enough money to shoot for another couple of weeks.
Yes.
He had to like pay off some balances and then do more.
Interesting.
But there was one scene in that film which takes place at a barbershop where Robert Townsend is speaking with, maybe it was his uncle or something, and he, Robert Townsend is discouraged by the industry, and his uncle is telling him, don't give up your dreams. It's really some wonderful dialogue. We shot that at a barbershop over on Pico Boulevard, and what I was able to do as a DP on that project is, you had an older man, his uncle, who actually had given up his dreams, and that was a point of sorrow in the film, but Robert Townsend was this young man that he was trying to advise to walk a different path. And so as a DP, I was able to say, why don't we create this action by which the barbershop's closing up shop, and the barber's closing up shop, and he's progressively turning off lights as the scene unfolds. And let's make the final light only this sort of neon clock that actually looms behind Robert, so that we have this sense of time and almost the closing of a chapter of life. So I was able to work with the director, Robert, on that, and that actually, in that sense, the lighting becomes a character in that film. Now, you could have just had fluorescence overhead and left them on the whole time,
right. And
the scene would have come off fine because of the great performances and the dialogue, but there's another dimension that comes about when you, as a DP, really play an active part in trying to further the director's telling of the story.
I love your line, and lighting becomes a character in the film.
Absolutely, and it's really important to understand things like, very fundamental things, like the grayscale, tonality, to really play with things like underexposure or overexposure, to really look at, if you're going to backlight, how thick should the rim and the edge light be? Should it be more expressionistic, for example, in a heavier look on a job we did, it takes place in a boxing ring in LL Cool J's backlit. And in that project, I really wanted a deeply expressionistic feel with very thick, hot highlights. And so we put a lot of smoke in the room and had the backlight really almost explode at the rim of his character. So, it's subtle. Now you have a drama in which, again, there are these subtexts going on. And what do you... how do you convey what's going on in the inner world of the characters? Because we all know that we deceive each other all the time.
Totally.
And what I'm saying is not necessarily reflective of what's happening. And so the DP can work with the production designer. Of course, you'd work with the production designer to bring about the studio or whatever your setting is. And that's really important. And then, of course, it depends on whether you're shooting a feature or a narrative or, say, a music video. Now, with a music video, there are no holds barred.
That's true.
And you can go wherever you want from a visual perspective and take all kinds of liberties with lighting. And there's no need for continuity. In fact, discontinuity can be far more exciting in that context. So it's really immersing yourself. And I would say for anyone that is an aspiring DP or even early on in his or her career, immerse yourself in the masters, both in the music video realm, in the narrative realm, and really see what they did. And at the end of the day, though, make it your own. Don't emulate anyone else, but innovate.
But you're right about the masters, and I'm a big fan of going to museums and just
Absolutely.
Seeing how they lit a scene. Because in a painting, they lit it. It's lit.
Absolutely, yeah.
And people like Rembrandt and stuff, the lighting is so powerful. And I'm a big believer that what you don't see is just as important as what you see.
Absolutely.
So shadow, yeah. we there's a lot of guys that think I'll just blast the scene
right.
and get rid of all the shadow. No,
right.
that's
oh no. Shadows are powerful, and you know. And you can do things. For example, if you have a shadowed area, you can still have that area production designed. You might even decide in the shadow area to bring out the tonality just a little bit to subtly indicate what's back there. You might actually have then that subtly increase in its luminance as the scene unfolds or decrease. I think that's really important. And with respect to paintings, you get into, and I think that a DP should spend a lot of time in galleries as well. And not just looking at the classics, but also looking for the 20th
stuff.
Century and the way Impressionists in the late 19th century, early 20th century worked. Going into abstract expressionism, a lot of the movements coming out of Germany, for example, where they played with different degrees of harshnesses with respect to lighting. And then, of course, you have a very soft approach to light as well. Gordon Willis gave us beautiful...
He was brilliant.
Yeah, absolutely.
So let me ask you this. A director of photography's relationship with the director on the project, mm-hmm. how does that work?
Yeah. So different directors have different emphases, different preferences. There are some directors that really don't want to deal with the photography really at all.
Okay. They're
focused on actors. Reportedly, Joel Schumacher is one such director. But there are many, and I've worked with many directors whose focus on the photography varies. Some are really not concerned at all. They want to focus, again, wholly on the actors. Others are very meticulous, and they want to see a 40-millimeter lens here, and they want to see a certain kind of lighting. And I think the director obviously needs to engage the director. The DP needs to engage the director prior to production, prior to signing the contract. Make sure this is someone that you feel really compatible with. And then it's your job to bring all that you are to the table, but in a way that's compatible with and complimentary to the director. There are times where directors are comfortable with actors. Often actors will lean over to the DP and say, how did I do? Because they want a second set of eyes on it. Now, some directors would freak out over that. They're like, no, the acting director relationship is just you and me, you know. But others are saying, you know, Stephen, how did that look to you?
Yeah.
So
interesting.
It's really you're there to serve the director. And I also think that a little tension is a good thing. You always want to be serving the director because the director is the kingpin or the queenpin. But at the same time, I think you want to bring contrast. I think you're there not to be a mirror image of what the director's initial instincts are, but to bring different perspectives. So the director can say... can see a range of things you've considered. John Williams is a composer, and I think as an analogy, this really holds up. When he was creating that five-note theme for Close Encounters, he said that he created like over 100 like five-note tunes and brought like 100 of them or something like that to Spielberg.
Wow.
And Spielberg said, I like that one. And that's, I think, a way that a director likewise can really serve. Rather, a DP can serve a director to give you options.
Interesting, yeah.
And can tell you the consequences of these options as well.
Very good. And has that changed any with the advent of things being more digital these days? The relationship doesn't change.
It shouldn't change. Yeah. Unfortunately, often... I think a kind of laziness can set in when you're looking at monitors now and people are sort of enslaved to... what you're seeing on screen. I think sometimes, I mean, the reality is what you're capturing with a camera is not a screen. The screen is really reflective of a set or a location reality made up of many, many elements. And I think that I would say the attention really needs to be on the set or the fullness of the location. And when you engage your director as well, you want to be able to show the director aspects of what's going on and the implications of this lighting approach as opposed to that one. Often, though, with monitors, you're looking it's like a semi-final image, actually.
True.
And I think that the range of things that are discussed in that context can be a lot fewer because the director's often getting a sense of the overall image and how that works. And the DP also, very often, unfortunately, is often focused in a very limited way on what he or she is actually depicting. You know, the old school directors, even when videotape came about, you know, never looked at that at all. They were standing next to the lens.
Yes.
And the DP and the director were both, and the operator was operating, were both looking at the fullness of the scene, and they would discuss what they were seeing in the fullness. It's kind of been reduced a little bit.
It really
I think, yeah.
It really has. Now, let's talk about people skills. I'm a big believer that a DP on a set is a leader because you have a whole team that you're working with, aside from actors and everybody else. But the more people I talk to in the industry, the more I realize that people skills are just as important as the skills it takes to be a DP. If you can't get along with people on the set, you're not going to get very far. I mean, is that your experience?
It's interesting because I've seen autocrats create great work. It's interesting. I think that a DP, I think a crew, everyone on the crew from the PA, even coming up the ranks as a DP on no budget jobs where, you know, the standard was to grouse about how little you're getting paid. I would never permit that on my jobs. For everyone working under my auspices, the camera department that gripped the electrical, I always insisted they have a great attitude so that this poison would never contaminate the set. And I don't care whether you're being paid four times your rate or a fourth of your rate, you're going to have the same attitude. And I think that's the way sets should operate. And that's important because a director needs to be able to focus on his or her craft. And the talent, the artists have got to be free and in their own headspace, unencumbered by, unaware of this drama going on or attitude. They need to be completely given over to really, really developing these characters. And that's what the entire crew owe you, the director, and the talent as well. So I think that it's really important. Now, that said, you know, different department heads, depending on the personality and the person in charge, operate with different levels of sort of totalitarianism. I don't think there's an excuse to be rude, but I have to say, great works, like great symphony orchestras have been conducted by, I mean, like Toscanini as a conductor was an absolute autocrat. It would be hilarious. If you go to YouTube, you can listen to audio recordings of the rants.
Oh, really?
On the bass section for not getting that note right, but he extracted some of the most amazing music. So, I don't think you have to be congenial to get great things on screen, but I do think that it makes for a more wonderful experience, and I also think it's more supportive, of course, of the director and of the cast. So, and I do think a DP is critical for that because a DP is really the head of the below the line sector. And although I have nothing to say with regard to the costumer or the sound mixer, these are other departments. Still, the DP sets the stage for that. So I think as a DP, you set the example, absolutely. You're congenial, you are kind, and yet you're always very firm to your crew about what you need from them so that there's no equivocation whatsoever. And you sometimes have to be firm. I lost a gaffer. I was shooting a film called Order of the Eagle, and we were shooting in a quaint lodge, and there's a fireplace scene where two guys are playing chess in front of it, and one is an older black man, one is a middle-aged white guy. And I wanted to create a certain fire effect, and because of the constraints of the location, I needed a certain rig to be sort of, and because it was not really a filming-friendly site, I needed some really serious jury rigging with respect to the... Anyway, my gaffer, we were on location in the Sequoias. It was like an hours-long drive back, but he just ultimately resisted... It was just too much work. It was too much hassle. He wasn't a can-do kind of a guy, which is some of the tough things you work up with confronting on low-budget jobs. You're paying someone $1 trillion. They'll stay there and work to cure cancer for you while you're on location. But at the end of the day, I know my director. His name was Tom Baldwin. I know that he wanted this effect. I wanted this effect. And I fired him mid-scene and sent him back to Los Angeles from the Sequoias. And I bumped my best boy, a woman named Pam, up to the gaffing position. And she actually nailed that.
I think, honestly, looking back at my career, I think one of the biggest mistakes I've made over the years is settling. You know, I went on the set when I should have pushed harder to get an effect or get a look or get a stop, something. I just... thought, you know what, we'll just go on. And I regret, I could name a number of times back where I regretted not being firmer. And I agree with you. You don't have to be a jerk about it.
Right.
You don't have to be a jerk. But I do think if you have a vision, you need to push to make it happen.
I think it's really important. And, Phil, it's a process. Because, and if you were producer-director on those jobs, you're wearing two hats. And you're, that's inner conflict.
That's true.
And an example of that, and I talk about this sometimes because it's so important. If you've ever seen the behind-the-scenes footage of the Lord of the Rings trilogy, by the way, the behind-the-scenes are as interesting as the amazing films were themselves. But when you get to the last film, Return of the King, you had Peter Jackson. And, of course, there's incredible tension because the release date's been set. And when a release date is set for a film, that means all the prints have to be struck by a certain time. It's sort of bat times when you need things done successively. And, you know, the composer, Howard Shore, is cooped up in a in a hotel, you know, trying to compose. He has to compose X number of bars a day to get this done. But Peter Jackson is still demanding, in other words, picture's not locked yet, and Peter Jackson is demanding
changes.
And then, and there's this great footage at one point of him, at one point, I mean, I'm talking like the release date is here, everyone feels it, and you see them sweating and, you know, buckets, and Peter Jackson's like, it's still not good enough. And in one certain situation, rather in one scene, it's a scene in which there's an attack of creatures of some kind. And he, out of the blue, just demanded that there be a lot more and different kinds of creatures in the scene than had ever been conceptualized. They had shot no green screen for it. There was nothing at all. And he's suddenly demanding basically a whole new cast to be imposed upon an already filmed scene. And when he leaves the room, you just see everyone's heart just like break out of their chest with panic, you know. And yet it wins Best Picture, because somehow when you hold out for what's best, you might not get every last thing that you need. But when you hold out for what's best and you have your team doing it, and it's critical to have everyone from the PA to your first AD and everyone else, you know, they're supporting the same team. And I've had some great team members over time, very grateful to Andy Park and many, many others who've worked with me. Then you create something that is absolutely unreasonable in the best sense.
That's good.
And at the end of the day, don't worry. You know, the clock's going to tick its last. Right. Production will get shut down, and you'll go back to your bed that night. But, you know, break that barrier. I remember one time, this is, I was shooting a music video in Los Angeles at a place called the Harvard House. It's an old house by the 10 freeway in Harvard that was always rented out. It was a gutted house interior, but it was always used for productions. And I was shooting a two-day music video. I was so far behind schedule, and I myself was at the point of compromising on some key points. And I remember my sister Jamie visited. Jamie's a Christian. I wasn't a Christian yet. I was about a year away from becoming a believer. And I was saying, I was freaking out. I was sharing this with her. And she goes, Stephen, pray and just see if there's something else that can happen. Don't give up. You know, even for me, it was 11th hour. It was like time to start compromising. She's like, no, go right. And so we prayed at the car across from the location. I remember that. And I just needed a little more time to nail a few key setups that would really then be the linchpins for this music video. And lo and behold, as it happens, it was daylight savings time. And because of that, the clock went back. We gained an extra hour of production. I got everything I needed.
Had
I given up and sent the crew packing, I would have said no to the blessing before it came.
That's pretty funny. Well, I think this whole episode is captured right there in this last 60 seconds, because the idea of not giving up, pushing to the limit. And again, you don't have to be a jerk about it.
No,
you don't have to be an autocrat
or
a dictator.
Yeah.
But I think it's about inspiring people to want to knock themselves out.
Absolutely, Phil. And I think that what's important is this, and I think this is key. Don't hire anyone ever. First of all, be someone who is 1,000% sold out for the project. It doesn't matter who you are. You enslave yourself. You shackle yourself to what's going to happen when that curtain rises, or aren't curtains anymore, but you know, or when that screen comes on. You be that person, and don't hire a soul who's not sold out for the same reason. You want a team of people that are can-do people, that are looking to bring about the very, very best you've got. And then you know that when you do have to compromise, you have gone the distance.
Yeah. The rule I follow is hire slowly and fire quickly. You know, take your time, make sure you got the right team, the chemistry's working. Don't be too quick to hire somebody.
Right.
But then when it's time to go, like the scene at this
out
the lodge, when it's time to cut them, it's kind of time to
and
cut
them. And I think that's vital for great filmmakers and just in the practice of art and craft in general. I'm not someone that says, because I believe that it's one thing if someone lacks a skill that you can teach them. My first feature as a DP, I remember we had bellows as opposed to hard mats at the end of our, and we had bellows. And I remember I extended bellows too far for shooting one scene in particular for some of the wide shots, meaning that the screen vignetted. And now after I made that mistake, I wasn't fired and went on to do more jobs. I knew I would never do that again. That was correctable because that was a craft thing that I was just, okay, I'm never gonna do that again. One time I was shooting a music video for a prominent group, and my camera, my film speed was out of sync with the HMIs, and I got flicker on that.
Yeah.
And I never did that again. So that's one thing. You can keep someone on like that because you know that they're the last person to do that again. But when it comes to something of character, when it comes to an attitude, that's not something I intend to teach anyone on a job. So, yes, I believe in firing quickly with respect to that. And may they be blessed with something else and learn on the next job they go to.
All right, so tell me about Steal Away. Now, here's the deal. You've made a transition. You're moving into producing now. And tell me about this new project that you're developing right now.
So about 8 years ago, I was looking to transition. I set down my light meter, and I stopped doing music videos as well, and I began looking for an amazing project. For a long time, I put a lot of dark content into this world, a lot of very, very hardcore hip-hop music videos, which glorified and glamorized a lot of things that I'm ashamed of. I actually printed a retraction. I put out a Los Angeles Times unclassified ad and took out I printed a retraction just for the record that I have to renounce the things I was doing. But I began looking for a project of light, and my wife and I had a painting hanging over our den that we didn't really know the story of. We'd seen a wall builders video talking about the 19th century political situation in America, and they just quickly showed this portrait of a choir of young former slaves. And they mentioned that it had been commissioned by Queen Victoria. Hmm. And it was just a great image. We were decorating our home at the time. My mind was someplace else with respect to, I was still doing music videos at the time, but we bought the painting and it sat over hung over our fireplace. And then now when it came flash forward, we're looking for a great project to do that would be light. We said, let's look into their story. Bought the book that tells their story called Dark Midnight When I Rise, and their story was so stunning that almost from the first page, my annotations and the margins and underlinings seemed like they were as much as a printed text. And it's, in short, the true story, post-Civil War, of a choir of young former slaves fighting the KKK's reign of terror against their schools, not with bullets or bombs, but with the sensational music, the spirituals. They resurrected the spirituals and said, we're going to take to the road to raise money to save our schools, spread the message of the gospel of hope and freedom, and really try to win the heart of America, because Congress was at a crossroads. At this bright, shining moment, radicals ruled Congress, and these radicals wanted full equality for everyone. But there was a backlash in the South, and among moderates as well, that wanted to take back and claw back some of those rights that had been given. So this choir wanted to win the hearts of America, and against all odds, they took America by storm, brought about desegregation, and crossed the Atlantic to Europe to raise more money. There were deeper pockets there, and they ended up also just conquering Europe. Queen Victoria became a fan in 1874, which resulted in that great commission. If anyone were to Google Fisk Jubilee Singer's portrait, you'll see the image that comes up. And it's an amazing story. It's a rags-to-riches-to-rags-to-redemption story, and it's unbelievable. And ultimately, it's a story of hope, and it's a story of defeating darkness with light. If I can share with you one episode. This is just one example of sort of the incredible effect they had in the world. So Alexander Stevens was called the godfather of the Confederacy. He was the vice president of the Confederacy. Okay. And here's one of the speeches he made. It's an excerpt, just a couple sentences, called his cornerstone speech. He's on record as saying, our new government, that's the Confederacy, is founded. In fact, its cornerstone rests upon the great truth that the Negro is not equal to the white man, that slavery subordination to the superior race is his natural and normal condition. And our new government is based upon this great physical, philosophical, and moral truth. Wow. And such was the foundation of the Confederacy.
Incredible.
Well, when he encounters the Jubilee Singers, again, this ragtag choir of young former slaves that are just traveling the country
and brilliant at what they do.
They were sensational. The man broke into tears, and by the time they left him, this man vowed to do everything he could to help their cause.
Wow.
So wherever they went, they just melted hearts of hatred. And so this is a story. It's a white story. It's a black story.
Yeah.
It's a young story. It's an older story. It's a wee story, because the quest of this choir, which is to bring about freedom and knock down the walls of bigotry, the walls that separate all men, which is scriptural, was their quest, and they did this. So when we discovered the story, I shut down all work, and I undertook what would become an 8-year writing process. It's an epic story along the lines of a Braveheart or a Gladiator or a Schindler's List, and many, many revisions, a lot of coverage, and we're now in the process of pitching this project in here and in London, and that's what we're doing.
So when it comes to transitioning from being an artist as a DP to becoming a producer, how does your thinking have to change?
So much. You know, even the process of writing the script was kind of tied into the artist, the artisan thing. But I'll give you an example. I have a great assistant working with me named Natasha, and we have sent out thousands of emails to production executives around the world about this project, to pitch the project. And there was a lot of interest, fortunately, in various corners. But still, I had a friend of mine rebuke me because in these emails, I wasn't sort of cornering people and saying, you know, can I meet with you about this? I had to really, I've never been someone to just be kind of salesy.
Pushy, yeah.
I've had to become much more proactive and much more, and that's actually garnered a lot more meetings, actually.
Really?
Yeah, it actually has. And the number of emails I get back from executives at Sony and whatnot, when I shifted and really applied what my friend taught me, has been great. But also at the same time, from a fiscal perspective, producing's always been on my mind because, as I said, those early jobs I did, I mean, were brilliantly produced. Now, none of those genre films, you know, ever won an award,
yeah.
I mean, except for like worst movie of the year. You know, these were like horror films and action films and war films, things like
yeah.
Sorority Babes and the Slimeball Bowl of Rama. Battleground, Jungle Assault. But they were brilliantly produced. By the way, some of those have cult followings as far away as Australia. I get emails from time to time. Anyway, but they were brilliantly produced. They would yeah. take $100,000 and with $100,000 create a three-week shoot on location, full cast and crew, stunts, pyro. There was at least one helicopter day for and whatnot. And that was from development through the answer print. So I've always known that I've wanted to take that approach and use it even in the making of this story. And I want to do that particularly because, first of all, I don't think we need to spend as much money as we're spending to make content, but also because the less something costs, the less the exposure financially to investors.
Sure.
And that means I can take chances and bring on and bump people up in the ranks. Everyone that's working today, every director, every DP, every costumer, everyone in media, every executive was given a break. They prove themselves to somebody, and someone else has had the courage to say, I'm giving you the leg up. And I want to be the person in Realm, my company, is the company that is going to give vast, vast swaths of people a leg up. People who have already proven themselves to be amazing, but now the lower you make something in cost, the more reasonable and acceptable that is to investors, because you're spending a lot less money to make that
happen.
Good. Yeah.
Very cool. So Realm Entertainment is your company.
Realm Entertainment.
That's realm-entertainment.com.
Right.
Realm-entertainment.com. Check it out to find out everything that's going on, right? They can get updates from there.
Thanks, Phil. Yeah.
No, happy to do it. And because I love this, I love the concept, love the project. And I think this has been a great conversation. I appreciate you being open and honest about your career. This is great.
I've always loved talking to you. So it was just that coming home in a sense to be here. I've been in this very room many times.
This is funny. Well, listen, you share this with people because there's a lot of people out there that, you know, one of my great frustrations is that film schools kind of inspire everybody to be a director or be an actor, but being a DP, being a director of photography is a great, powerful, influential niche out there.
I think
it's just extremely important. And I'd encourage you know people that would come up, be interested in coming up that way, share this with them. I think it's important. And then, we could trend, anybody interested in producing will want to see this for a lot of reasons because we've taught about leadership and all the things you can do on a set. So check us out. Share this with people. Give us a comment or two. Rate us. And it helps us move up. It helps more people see it. And also, remember, come join me at philcooke.com and our blog. And stay tuned. We've got some great topics coming up. We're going to have some future episodes that are going to be absolutely fascinating. So absolutely, please keep watching.